So today I'm going to be talking about the pipeline that we've set up at Machine Zone, my company, that's allowing us to do real-time analytics. It's using WebSocket, Python 3, and Redis PubSubs. So my name is Benjamin Sergent. I've been at MZ for 3.5 years. I've been working on real-time systems, crash monitoring, and fast asset delivery. Before that, I was at DreamWorks and Adobe working on computer graphics. So we're going to start by giving an overview of our system, which is a PubSub system. So it consists of, like, there is a publisher component, a subscriber component, and in the middle you have like what we could think about like the server, which is which we call the broker in the proper PubSub terminology according to Wikipedia. And that's responsible for dispatching messages back and forth. But we're going to start by time traveling to the 70s and using Oak as an example to illustrate what I would call extreme programming and how we would do like analytics if we only had Oak. That would be pretty hard, but let's try. So Oak is a classic Unix command line tool. It takes its input from standard in, a stream of data. It processes it, and then it outputs something on standard out. So an Oak program consists of a set of rules. Each rule is an action and a pattern. So when Oak is matching a pattern in the input, it's going to execute an action. So here we have $1 equal FPS. FPS stands for frame per second, which is something very important for gaming. It tells you how smooth your experience is, how many times you can render within a single second. So when the first token here in our stream is FPS, and each line is broken down into tokens using a separator. So here we have like colon for the separator. So when the first token is FPS, we're going to extract the second token. So one cool stuff with string programming is that we don't need to like load the whole file into memory. So we can just, so this has like nice memory properties, for example. So now imagine we're using PubSub for analytics. We time travel back to today's time. So our event, instead of being those kind of lines with colon separator, they are like JSON documents. We still have an ID. We still have like a data field. But since it's a JSON document, it's hierarchical, we can represent much more data. It's more rich. It's easier. And so the publishers, which are the things on the left-hand side, but are going to like push data to the broker, which is kind of Oak, if you want. And then there is a subscriber, which is going to execute an expression on the broker and capture data. So in Oak, we had those Oak programs in our system. We have what we call extreme SQL expression, which kind of are equivalent. So here we're extracting the data.fps field. So we're using this dot notation. I think there is something in JSON called like JSON schema. I'm not too sure, but that lets you express like how do you address a field in your JSON document. There is the same thing with XML, like something called XPath, I think. So that's what we're using here. We're extracting a field from a channel. So here we can have a subscriber or a bot or like some program that's doing some analytics, which is just focusing on FPS, frame per second. And we have as many publishers as we want. We have as many events coming, flowing through the system. But we can have also like as many subscribers as we want. So here we have a second subscriber, which is just focusing on memory, for example. And it's extracting like memory information. So this is kind of how our system works. So our system should be real time. It should be fast. So it should work on mobile, because this is our platform. We are a mobile game company, like doing mobile games on iOS and Android. So of course, that's a big requirement for us. We should be able like to publish data through to our broker on mobiles. It should be flexible and extensible. We don't want to have to run some like special commands whenever we add like a new event type, for example. This should be automatic. And it should be easy to write a new subscriber. We're going to go talk to like a whole bunch of different teams within our company. And if it's kind of a very complicated to use your system, no one will want to use it. So this is a strong requirement. So we don't want to guarantee So what are our known goals? Our known goals is that we're not guaranteeing that our message are going to be delivered. We could, but we don't really need to, because those are application health events. Like if we're losing one FPS recording, no one cares. We don't have history, so it works around like PubSub. So if someone is subscribing and listening, we're going to get this message. But if no one is going to, if there is no subscriber listening to a channel, the message is being dropped. And the nice, another like non-goal for us is we don't want to fill hard drive, because like last Friday, I had another system which is using hard drive, and I was paged at midnight to sort out a problem, and I don't want to have to deal with filling hard drive with this system. So we have like three components. We're going to start by looking at publishers in more details. So this is how like publishers talk to our brokers. So here we have a more like comprehensive example of the kind of data that we are sending. It's not, it's still like simplified, but we have like more, it's more representative. So we still have a data block here, like data FPS colon 30. But we also have a device subfield that contains a bunch of common things that you would want to filter on. Say if you are, you're doing analytics, we have many different games. We run on many different operating systems. We have many versions of our game. So we want to know like this, if this event coming from like Android, iOS, game foo, game bar, etc. We again, we have our ID to identify the kind of event that's being sent. We have a timestamp, and we also have a session key, a session attributes, which we generate on the client side, and this is very helpful to group message that belongs to the same run together. So the communication between the publisher and the broker starts by doing some security business, because we don't want to let anyone authenticate to our system. So there is like a nonce generation on the server, an HMAC business going on. I'm sure security people would love to hear me talk in those terms about security, but we're making sure only legit people can connect to the broker and publish data. But once they are connected, they can publish. And this communication goes over our WebSocket transport. So what is WebSocket? So WebSocket, it's a bidirectional full duplex communication protocol. So bidirectional means that the clients can push data to the server, and the server can push data to the client. It works both ways, kind of unlike a classic HTTP. A full duplex means that the communication can happen simultaneously. So you can, the communication can happen simultaneously, I guess. I don't really have to explain that. The connection is persistent. So if we were dropping the connection every time, we would have to go like through like the overhead of reestablishing it, which would be very costly. So that's one nice thing. It's kind of like HTTP keep alive, if you want. So the connection stays around, and we can push on messages, a lot of messages. It's WebSocket is compatible with HTTP, so that's very nice, because if you're in an environment where you have like a firewall and lots of ports are closed, it doesn't affect us, because we go through like port 80, port 443, and it's very compatible with HTTP, because the communication starts by doing something called like an HTTP upgrade, where like the messages are exactly like HTTP. So like it's going to go like WebSocket traffic is going to go through like the whole HTTP interface just fine. So the S in HTTPS means that we can encrypt this traffic too. So we're using TLS, so no one can spoof on our traffic. Another nice thing with WebSocket is that if you have there is a JavaScript API to talk to a broker, so you can write like a real-time system that talks to your WebSocket broker. There is zlib compression. There is an extension in WebSocket. And that's very helpful for us, because as you did notice, there is a bunch of repetition in our messages, like all the device field. This is being repeated all over for every messages, but it doesn't matter too much if we zlib compress it, because it's gonna compress very well. For us, it gives us like a 20x compression ratio. So that's very nice. There is also a heartbeat, a native heartbeat mechanism as part of WebSocket, where you send like ping and pong messages. So you don't need to implement an application level heartbeat to keep the connection open. And the last thing that comes with WebSocket is that you can have very large messages that are broken down into little chunks. So we wrote our own WebSocket implementation in C++ because this is what our engine is written in. There is Lua for the game logic, but C++ for the real stuff, the real fast things. And it's open source. You can go on GitHub. You can start it. It's going to make me happy. I know I shouldn't be doing like self-promotion, but I'm doing it. Like whenever I see a new star on this GitHub page, it makes my life. I'm at 20 stars now. Amazing. That's pretty sad. Maybe I'll get to 100 one day. I'll celebrate. So why did we do that? The main reason is that we need our game installs to be really small. Like when you download a new game and it's very big, like people just don't want to do that. And all the existing C++ implementation we found were based on Boost, which is has like a larger footprint. So to keep our binary small, we redid it ourselves. Plus we are going through an effort of like getting rid of Boost. We actually made a party when we got rid of Boost. I'm sorry if there is any Boost fan here. I have no problem with Boost. It's just in the mobile industry in gaming, we're trying not to have like big dependencies. Our implementation is also asynchronous and interruptible. So this is important because on a mobile OS, if you are blocking the main thread, the OS is going to kill you. So that's not good. We also have like our zlib compression, auto reconnection logic, Heartbeat, all those features that are in WebSocket that are implemented in our library. There is a server. Aspect, you can do server. You can write server code with this library and client code with this library. There is a command line tool that comes with it that does all sorts of things. That I've used this to make sure that the library was solid. There is an HTTP client, like a chat thing, like a file transfer service too. Okay. So now let's talk about the broker. The broker, the core component is a PubSub system. But on top of that, we need some form of authentication for security. We need our Stream SQL evaluation engine, WebSocket, and JSON serialization. So we wrote it in Python. So I said, what's a catchy name for Python? Cobra. And so this is what we picked. And we did use Redis for the subscriber. So there was another analytics team at my company that was using Kafka, which looks like a very proven solution. But it was more complicated to set up. You need to run Zookeeper. You need, I think the install is like 1 gig. So, and I just couldn't get it to work. So that's the real reason, which maybe is not a great reason, but it still tells a story about like how like simple systems are good. And so with Redis, there was no such problem. It was already running on my machine. I just went to the I just Googled like PubSub Redis. I found tutorial. All my client libraries were already supporting it, and just getting something going took like a couple of hours, I guess. And also, like I don't know if you ever look at this Redis manifesto, but you should do it. It's great. I think there are lots of points that try to define what's the mindset of Redis, and the last point is joy. Like you should program and have joy when you do that. So why did we use Python? So another like bad reason or good reason is this is something I've been using for like 15 years, so that probably was a big factor in the decision. I was really afraid that we couldn't be able to handle a lot of connection with Python. So I was, I should learn like a Go or a Node.js, but I did some research, and with Python 3.5, there is this thing called async.io, which is a new way to do like asynchronous networking or like I/O, like you could work with file too. That's very scalable and efficient, and it is indeed. And you can have like the new keyword async and await that let you write like a sequential code that actually execute in parallel concurrently for anything that's I/O. You still have this gil limitation, but this is just a networking code, so we're not doing like too much processing, so it's fine. It's written on top of UVLoop, which is the same library that's used by Node.js, which is good at I/O. And there are tons of libraries with Python, so there is a WebSocket library, there are extremely fast JSON parser written in C. There is an optional type checker in Python 3.5, and there is also memory debugging tools. So we started by having a system that was really broken, and we did like many optimization to get to a scalable state. So the first optimization that we made was looking at all the memory allocation, and there is a new module called Trace Malloc that let you do that very easily. So we realized that the Redis clients that we were using were not as optimal as they could be, like it would like copy data, create strings, all sorts of stuff that we could optimize. So we actually wrote like a publish-only async IO client, and that speed up our system a little bit. That's one kind of optimization you can do if you have something high performance, if you want to have something high performance. The other stuff that we did is that we did batch all our messages by sacrificing some latency for throughput. So we're queuing, we have a queue, we push messages, incoming messages coming from the publisher. That's the workload we need to optimize, because we have like 400,000 connection, 400,000 open connection at a time, like pushing data to our system. So we're batching them, and every 100 milliseconds we dispatch it, we push them to Redis. Second optimization and last optimization is that to be able to work with multiple Redis instances, we're using like channel sharding. So we're computing a hash using something called like consistent hashing, which is nice when you need to remove nodes out of your node pool. So yeah, if I'm removing Redis too, you know, with hashing, you have this modulo operation that you do usually, consistent. So if you're like shrinking the set of nodes or increasing the set of nodes, now like your hashing is going to be awful. Consistent hashing solves that. So I said, I told you that we have like this StreamSQL evaluation engine. So really the idea behind that is that sometimes you have a very high frequency message, like we have an a metric that sends for every HTTP request. But we have tons of them, and sometimes we're just wondering about, we're just interested in, say, like Android request or iOS request or something like that. So we can execute a filter on the broker, and this way we only download very few messages. So those are examples of how we would use this StreamSQL expression. So it's written in Python. I have like a really simple like evaluation engine that just does that. So here we have two examples. Like in the first one, we're just looking at all incoming HTTP traffic, and we're just looking for errors, like error code 404, or like anything that's not 200. And the second example is looking at our CDN traffic, which can be like complicated sometimes. You never know like how this is performing. I guess you can go to like Akamai web admin page, but that's not something that most developers have access to. So like, here we have the power to look at every single request that the game is making, and we can make sure that we are like, sometimes we use like new texture file formats to speed up like graphics, and we want to make sure that we're using the proper files, not PNG, for example. So we are deploying this system on OpenShift, which is a Kubernetes distribution. It's a really very nice tool. So it makes it extremely like easy to scale your system. You just edit a config file, replace one with 5 or one with 60, and it does everything for you. So we have 60 Python nodes that are dedicated to all the publishing traffic, 10 nodes that are dedicated to the subscriber traffic, and 5 Redis nodes. So Redis is extremely reliable. It's been running, it never crashed. So we're really happy with that. So now let's finish by talking about the subscribers. So we have what I would call like an ecosystem of subscribers. So we have like little analytics tools that focus on, say, FPS, or like FPS for the graphics team, like HTTP for like the analytics teams, analyzing like what people are doing into the game. And every team wants to work with a different language. So in our system, you just need a WebSocket library, a JSON marshalling library, and you can write like an SDK for our system. So And once we get to this traffic, usually we redirect it, we're republishing to like a system that's really good at doing something. For example, like time series database with StatsD or Sentry for our error monitoring. So we have command line tools. That's the first example, the first kind of subscribers that we have. Those are written typically by developers. We don't always know how to write like nice UIs, myself included. And so here, for example, we have something that the graphics engineer did to get like a distribution of the FPS broken down by Apple devices. So there is a little real estate problem with that. It's Silicon Valley. It's very hard to get space in. So that's the problem with terminals. You don't have too much space. It doesn't scale too well. So we also have what I call Neo, which is a real-time dashboard. So it's a web application. And this thing lets you like subscribe to our broker and do a whole bunch of real-time things. And it's very nice. So here we are, we have like a world map. We're using Google Charts to display this. Well, we're displaying the time it takes to get into our game based on the country. So here we can see that in Chile, it's very slow to get into our game. I'm sorry about that, but you need to complain to Akamai if you're from Chile. And yeah, there is a search box where you can type in a query if you want. So everything is dynamic. If you just want to look at Android traffic, you go in there, you say device.os underscore name equal single quote Android, and now you have a new report, if you will, if you want. That's just focus and that's real time. We also use it to record like session, user session, and then we chart like those kind of things. Well, we can correlate user actions with, say, FPS spikes, or FPS drop, memory spikes, all sorts of stuff. So this is very helpful to point the finger at like what page or what action triggered like an application health problem, like errors, all sorts of stuff. That's another use case for our system. Another one that we use extensively is Grafana, StatsD, Graphite. You guys probably know about that, but that's something that's really good to record historical data and to chart it very easily. So we have like tons of dashboards. That's an existing one for like critical logs. That's another one where we're looking at the traffic for our system, which decreased like pretty significantly once we added zlib compression at the WebSocket level. Another data sync for our system, another subscriber type is Sentry, which is a really cool tool for looking at backtraces. So we use that whenever we have like critical error that's emitted, we use it and we can go explore, like expand the backtrace to see why this error was emitted. Like yeah, we only see like one frame, but if I had like more space, I could have displayed like you can see like every single function A calling to function B, etc. The last thing that we have as a data sync is Tableau, which is a good tool for data exploration. So when you have like many dimensions, say device model, iOS, you're kind of lost, you can use this to make like beautiful visualization. It's a great tool. So using this, for example, we discovered that our crash handler was not working on an old version of Android. So to conclude, if you're afraid to use Python for networking I/O, don't be afraid, it's fast. You don't need to drink all the Kool-Aid. Other languages are great too, but Python 3 is very capable. WebSocket is very flexible. It's very versatile. You can talk to many, you can talk to web browsers. You can run it everywhere. It's better, I think, in many respects than HTTP. It's not as good as HTTP if you want to do like CDNs kind of stuff. There are many things that HTTP is good at. So PubSub is extremely fast. And yeah, so I wrote like almost every single thing in this system. And what's really great when you have like such an analytic tool, I'm an engineer, so sometimes I look at code and I really wonder, are we ever like running into this branch? Could I just delete this code to make the code more maintainable? And usually as engineers, we never know how to answer those questions. But you can really build like a pipeline like that if you're a little motivated. It's possible. And with that, I'm happy to say happy birthday to Redis. And that's it. Thank you.